Good morning, everyone. I welcome you all officially to this 10th lecture of the Innovative Pedagogical Learning. It gives me immense pleasure today to welcome Dr. Vandana Reddy. She is today's speaker and she's a dear colleague. She did her post-graduation from Subharti Dental College in 2009 in oral pathology, which is the same specialty as me and Dr. Aman. So that's why, you know, we know her since a very long time. She's been actively involved ever since in teaching. And, you know, it is her interest and passion towards academics and research because of which she has bagged many best teacher awards and many best scientific presentation awards in various platforms. So she has, to her credit, numerous publications in very reputed international and national journals. Presently, she is working as a professor in her alma mater in the Department of Oral Pathology, Subharti Dental College, Meerut. And I'm sure, I'm not going to take much time, I'm sure we have a lot to learn from her today. So welcome, Dr. Vandana, over to you.
Please go ahead, Dr. Vandana.
Is the screen shown?
Yes.
Am I audible? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. A very good morning to one and all, to all the participants who are attending this webinar. And I really thank the team IPL. In a short notice, they have given me this opportunity to present my webinar on this topic, evaluating research output. Warm regards from Subharti Dental College, Meerut. This is a place where I work. I have been associated in this institution for the past 18 years. I really thank the management for giving me the opportunity to serve this institute for such a long period. So before I really introduce the topic, I think you all do recognize them. It's just because of the impact they have made on our lives. So how do we make impact as healthcare professionals? We need to keep pace with leaping ahead advances in the field of dentistry in order to provide utmost care and quality service. And how is that possible? Thinking. Thinking will create ideas, and these life-changing ideas will transform into reality by means of meticulous research, which can really rule the world. Research probes, it explains, it analyzes, it even answers questions which can be utilized to widen horizons of knowledge and skill. It investigates hypotheses and poses new questions for further research. To transform this research into clinical practice and dental education, you need to publish them. No matter what the deal is, liability should turn into an asset, and instead of pressure, there should be pleasure associated with publication of valuable research. Not just if you don't publish, you perish. Even you publish, you do perish. How? Because as said by a famous artist, Andy Warhol, in the future, everybody will be world famous for just 15 minutes will probably hold true for dental science too. What we urgently need is to develop better knowledge systems to know the quantitative and the qualitative aspects of publications and increase the quality of them. So here, I present the topic of the webinar today, Evaluating Research Output, Exploring the Unexplored. The aim of my presentation is to discuss in detail the various tools and techniques which are called as matrices, which will help the researcher in strengthening their efforts in enhancing the scientific productivity, visibility, reputation, and impact of their research work. So the reason for choosing this topic is these matrices, most of us should have, we would have heard of them, but they are wrongly used to evaluate science. Actually, what happens is we really do not know. By the end of this presentation, you all should know what are the different metrics which are used at different levels to analyze the research output, and how are they calculated, and what are the uses of them, and what are their limitations, and what are the combination of the matrices you need to use to evaluate science. So by the end of the presentation, I hope everybody will be knowing about all this through this presentation. So I'll be covering the topic under the following contents. Why do we generally publish? Ideally speaking, for progress in human knowledge, improvement of patient care, and scientific communication in the field. But practically speaking, we all publish for a career prospect, for making and protecting our intellectual property, to get a recognition, to get more grants. Our PGs do also have a solid reason, because otherwise they are not allowed for exams. That is how we follow in our college. I think Pan India, even this is followed. So though there are so many type of publications we have in the magazines, we have in newspapers, books. So what is a scientific journal? It's a periodic publication intended to further the progress of science, usually by reporting new research. Way back in the year 1665 came the first journals, which were the Journal de Savants and the British Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. In the year 1839 came the first dental journal, which is the American Journal of Dental Science. Since then, so much of medical and dental literature, with 50 million research articles by 2001, and that is doubling every 20 years. But are the readers' time doubling? What is the challenge faced by most of us? How to match the right people to the right articles? Because not all who are looking at a journal are going to read even one article in it. So writers must know what will turn a looker into a reader, but not just holding the sake a journal just for holding the sake of a journal. Just look at this. There are too many new research articles published each year in medical and dental journals. So the approach is to facilitate identification of sound medical evidence which has made impact by measuring the impact of knowledge, that is known as bibliometrics or altmetrics, which are the set of methods to evaluate the impact of publications at different echelons, including the level of a single author, a group of researchers, a specific paper, a journal, a particular field, or an academic institution. So what is this bibliometrics? Way back in the year 1961, it was given by Alan Pritchard. It means application of quantitative analysis and statistics to publications such as journal articles and their accompanying citation counts. That means you're complementing a quantitative measure to an already existing qualitative measure, which is a peer-reviewed journal article. But later came an alternative to this called as altmetrics in the year 2010, where you analyze or measure the scholarly impact by using the social media. So the measurements of this research output can be done at different levels. At level one is the article level. So alternatively, you can use the altmetrics. Level two is to assess the journals. And level three is to assess the individual researchers' output. So when we come to an article level metrics, so the level one article level metrics, which is the best way to assess an article, though there are so many methods, but the fundamentals of which paper to read can have different contexts. Because which new papers are relevant to me, which paper should I read if I'm going to pursue research X, which papers do I read before submitting my paper. So the metrics are useful in different contexts. But anybody you ask to assess an article, they say the gold standard is citations. Number of citations, that is, how many times a given article is counted in the reference list of subsequent article, is known as a citation. A journal article can be considered to have impacted someone else's work if another scholar cites that item in his or her subsequent publication. So why do anybody cite others' work? The reader should be able to check the source for its accuracy. The source is given credits for contribution, and source is identified as an object of research in its own right. So where do you get these citation counts? There are different citation databases. The most common ones are Web of Science by Thomas Reuters, Scopus by Elsevier, Google Scholar by Google. So which amongst these three should you follow? So when you talk about number of citations in a Google Scholar, though you might be getting so many citations for an article, it's better not to follow the Google Scholar, because it includes so much of gray literature. That means that no peer-reviewed articles are also published or indexed in Google Scholar. So to compare between Thomas Reuters or the Web of Science to Scopus, it depends from university to university. Most of the Asian journals are indexed in Scopus, and North American journals are indexed in Web of Science. So it's better to follow Scopus indexation. because most of the university who go for NAC inspection, they do ask for Scopus citations. So it's better to go for Scopus, which is even followed in a university. So the other citation databases, even like for Asian and Indian journal, the Indian Citation Index sites, there's so many of them. But what you should know here is they're mostly subscription-based. Only freely available citation databases are Google Scholar, Microsoft Academic Cert, and CiteSeal. Even the Indian Citation Index need an subscription for it. So I said to analyze an article, the best way is to check the number of citations. So when we talk about a super cited article, it was by Oliver H. Laurie, which was published in way back in the year 1951 on protein measurement with folinolone reagent. And it has got more than 2 lakh citations till date. That means there is no other article as good as it. It is not like that. What you should know here is these citation counts are influenced by disciplines. That means they can vary from maths to physics to science and different disciplines. You cannot compare articles when a person in a physics to a person in chemistry. And also, they're influenced by journals. An open access journal, which is freely available to see the whole article, will surely have more citations to that article published in the journal to an article published in a close review. It's also influenced by paper characteristics. That means what type of paper it is. Is it a review paper? Is it an original research? The number of pages, the number of authors in it. There's so many things it does depend on. So you can't directly compare two different papers and say that my paper is the best and your paper is not good. To make it simple to you, just look at this example. Impact of article page count and number of authors on citations and disability-related field systematic review. So in a nutshell, in this article, they say that articles receiving citations in this particular field itself are limited. That means the citation potential in that field is less, so that there will not be much of the citations seen in that particular journal and the articles published in them. The more the number of pages, that is more than 10 pages, less number of citations. More number of authors, more than 2 authors, and also it decreases the citation. So there's so many things you need to keep in mind before you see whether the citations in that particular article. So to overcome this, the differences in publication and citation behavior between disciplines, Scopus has come with a matrix to analyze an article, which is known as field-weighted citation impact. So what is this field-weighted citation impact means? Think if I have an article published in cancer on oral squamous cell carcinoma, the number of citations received for my paper over a 3-year window is compared to the average number of citations received by such same similar articles, which are belonging to the same publication type, same journal category, over the same temporal window. So when this is compared, if the value is more than one, then I can say that on a global average, my paper is being cited more. So if I say, if any field-weighted citation impact of an article is 1.44 means, that is, which is more than one, so that is, it is 44% more times it is cited on a global average. If it is less than one, if I say it is 0.85, that means it is 15% less cited on a global average. So this is how field-weighted citation impact has got an edge over the number of citations, which is only available on Scopus. For all those articles which are published in PubMed, which are indexed in PubMed index journals, so you can use this new metrics, which is known as relative citation ratio. So relatively means if you have a paper on lichen planus, if that is published in a PubMed index journal, that article is actually compared to NIH-funded papers of the same year and field. So you actually take out all your RCR values of all your PubMed index articles in this particular website, which is mentioned on the slide, and it will measure how influential your article is. If it is, then score comes 1 when it compares to NIH-funded papers. That means it is exactly as influential as NIH-funded papers. But if it is 2, that means it is twice as much influence. So since 1995, what all articles are there in PubMed? So you can see your RCR values of those PubMed index articles. So like any other Sunday, even my husband was resting. So, but I was so disturbed seeing this article, and I went to him saying, counting on citation, a flawed way to measure quality. Just look at this. Why citation counts are often misleading as a marker of quality? Because convenient citation, we all try to cite all that material which is easily available to us. We just Google a topic, whatever articles are available, we just write from those articles and cite those articles. A discovery paper, that is article that first put forward a new concept, is actually cited more. That means if I was the first one to publish an article on lip prints and people follow the same, they use the same using in South population, in West, in East population, and different population, and that paper will be cited more. Reputation citation, this is really followed these days. You try to cite your own work, which is known as self-citation, and you try to ask your colleague, you cite my work, I will cite your work, so that it increases the reputation of both of us, which is actually very wrong. An article, which is a review article, summarizing the research on a new on a topic, is cited more than an actually original research because everything is available in a single article. But why should that article be getting more citation where that author has not actually contributed anything to that? Viewpoint citation. We cite a work or a part of work which will support our hypothesis and will omit all that which doesn't. So by doing that, we are trying to convince the reader to believe our research findings. So these are different flaws actually which are associated with citations. So to overcome this, few international journals, what they have done, from their own journal advisory board, they have asked some 5 international members to select 3 publications per issue from their own journals. That is, they had some 3 publications in a year. So 3 publications per issue, they've asked them who have followed this particular criteria, like adding to the field through original innovative research finding, which has challenged the current knowledge existing and opening additional areas for new research, opening a pathway to advanced knowledge, and integrate discoveries obtained by different approaches. So 9 articles gaining the most votes were posted on the website of that particular journal, saying that these are the best journals. Though they were published in their own journal, still again, they were peer-reviewed too. They've asked them to select those and asked them to post them on their website, saying that these articles are good to read because they are giving some novel ideas. The same way, even DCI should come out with such new innovations, and they should select some different researchers all over Pan India, ask them to select articles monthly and post them on the website of the DCI. Another initiative is Faculty of 1000. Here, in different fields, here I have given an example of biomedical sciences, some 1000 scientists who are experts in their particular field are asked to select 2 to 4 papers each month from any journal, ranking them as recommended, must read, or exceptional. That means these are the papers which are really worth reading and which are really made an impact. So anybody who is a member of Faculty 1000 itself is a big adding to their CV. Alternative to this, I said there is another method you can use, which is known as altmetrics or an alternative metrics, which is using the social media to analyze the scholarly impact. And how is that done is, it is depending on the views and downloads on the journal website, saves to the reference manager systems like Mendeley or SiteScore, there's so many of them, posts and comments on scientific blogs, Twitters, Facebook, Google. So once all this is done, how is it calculated is, on this IDs which I have mentioned on the slide, you can download the bookmarklet. This bookmarklet can easily be downloaded and it is synced with anything like Chrome or Safari, anything. So any article when you are searching, a download appears like this once you download the bookmarklet. And there are different colors seen in the download and a score is seen in the center of it. The score which is seen in the center tells about the impact that article has made. And how that is made, the colors which are surrounding this donut tells us from this how the score is obtained. If you can see this, the blue color shows out of the 728, there were tweets of 618. That is how this particular article was tweeted more. That means so many people have read that article and tweeted. And so the score has increased to 728 with others like from different something blogs, some Google posts, etc. So any number more than 100. So these days, most of the journals do keep this altmetrics score too. So another way, as I said, altmetrics is depending on the social media, on the views, saves, posts and comments. With this bookmarklet, the donut, and the score which is seen in the center of the donut will tell about the impact of how that article has made. So keeping this in mind, they have selected some top 50 dental articles in the year 2014. And what does that say is, most of these articles were published in British Dental Journal. And it was because of the tweets, this altmetrics score has increased, followed by news outlet and many readers. And mostly the people who tweeted were the members of the public than actually the doctors or the healthcare professionals or the practitioners and the scientists too. So what should you keep in mind when you're looking at measuring an impact of an article? Because in a citation for an article to get cited, it takes about 2 to 6 years. So as soon as it gets published, you cannot say it is a good or a bad article. So what should you keep in mind? You can use this altmetrics like the Twitters, the Facebooks, the downloads. And also when it's in a long run, you can go for the citations. And again, you have to go for a good citation database than going for Google Scholar. So when anybody asks how much is too much for an article to say that it is a really made impact, it's really difficult because, as I said, there are so much differences. Citation potential is different in different fields and different subjects, different sub-subjects. You need to know the citation potential of that particular field, and then only you can speak about whether that article is really made impact or not. Just look at this particular study, which says that on a category of dentistry, oral surgery, oral medicine in the database of 2010 JCR, the 100 most cited articles in dentistry. So out of this, we had some 2000 citations for an article which was published in Critical Review of Oral Biology, and the author having some maximum citation, that is as a first author, was Sokransi with 5 articles of him in this top 100. And clinical-based research was most compared to that of the basic research. And Journal of Clinical Periodontology was on the top with 20 articles published amongst its 100 most cited articles. So that what does that mean? That this Journal of Clinical Periodontology is the best, and the article which was published in Critical Review of Oral Biology was the best. No way in this particular study it is involved with the qualitative assessment of the publications. But still it is important. How? They're telling us of the identification of citation trends and citation classics in dentistry. It provides an interesting look at which research findings, scientific articles, and authors have contributed to dental profession over time. So which direction the dental research may be heading towards in the future is told by such articles. So the take-home message for the article level metrics is always specify the database from which you are calculating the citation counts. And I said, you cannot compare papers that belong to different scientific fields or even subfields. Use this right form of normalization, even the age of the paper. An old paper will obviously have more citation compared to that of a new paper. So all these things need to be kept in mind. Then only you compare the citation counts to different articles. It's a short break, nothing to do with the research. We're going to the next level, which is the journal level metrics. So when you look at a journal, the first question which comes to our mind is, how good is this publication? Does this journal generally publish material that ends up being impactful? will my article have a better chance of being impactful because it is appearing in this particular journal? So because there's so many type of journals, right from institutional to international journals, when you talk about journal typology, we have multidisciplinary, specialized journals, mega journals. So even this boy who was one of my UG student was very happy, but one of his PG days, he came to me with a question, ma'am, what is an index journal? I said, indexation of a journal is considered a reflection of its quality. They're considered to be of high scientific quality as compared to a non-index journal. So to make it very simple to him, I said, all the dental literature are archived in well-known databases. So the private and government-aided agencies have to set their own set of criteria, rules, and regulations for listing a journal. So that means if I am the owner of a library, all the dental literature is there in that particular library. Some second person, think Aman or Dr. Priyanka, there are some private or government-aided agencies, they will have their own set of criteria to list whether that my journal should be there in their indexation or not. So because if at all it is indexed, the main advantage of it is it increases the visibility, accessibility, and the quality standard of the journal. So he, the next question which came from him was, which indexations are the best and the most valid? To name the many, PubMed, Embase, Thomas Reuters, Scopus, EBSCO, Science Citation Index, there are many to say. But many journals have this thing called as Index Copernicus or Google Scholar. So is it really to follow such indexation? So it's better not to follow such indexation because they are not of a good quality. They're actually only the sources, not indexation databases. Even DCI gives more weightage to those articles which are published in PubMed and Scopus. What are the different journal matrices otherwise available in Web of Science and Scopus? Let's see. Impact factor, immediacy index, cited half-life, Angel factor, article influence score. In Scopus, you have this SJR and SNIP values. What's an impact factor? Impact factor is an influence coefficient which was given by Garfield. So 2-year impact factor is there and a 5-year impact factor is there. 2-year impact factor means number of citations to a journal articles published previously 2 years divided by the number of articles published by the journal during those 2 years. So let me make it very simple to you. If I say IJMR for the year 2012 is got an impact factor of 2.061. And how is that calculated? For the year 2012. So in the year 2012, the number of citations it has received for those journals which have been published in the year 2011, and those were 232, and citations in 2012 for those which were being published in the year 2010 were 411, together the count is 643. And what were the number of publications in the year 2011? It was 146, and in the year 2010, it was 166. So the total number is 312. So citations number, that is 643 upon 312, gives us the score that is 2.061. That means the impact factor 2.061 that for that particular journal, for that particular year means on an average, the articles published in that year, that means for in 1 year or 2 years ago, have been cited 2 times. So you can only directly compare impact factor values among journals belonging to the same journal category, but not with others. Initially, this impact factor was used by librarians in selecting journals for library collections, but later it was used to assess the quality of a work of scientists, which is actually very wrong. So let us know what impact factor really tell us. The first question is, does impact factor permit assessment of the quality of the journals? Let's see. There are 2 journals here in the graph, Journal A and Journal B. Journal A has got more citations, that is 3,904 upon 560 papers published in the journal. And Journal B has got 1,399 citations upon 484 papers published in the particular journal. So when the value was calculated, the impact factor for Journal A was 6.97, for B was 2.89, which clearly says that yes, it indeed it permits assessment of the quality of a journal. But does impact factor permit assessment of the quality of an individual paper? Just look at this particular journal. So all the articles which were published in this journal were taken on the x-axis, and the citations received to them was taken on the y-axis. If you see here in this particular graph, 15% of the articles which were published in that particular journal accounted for 50% of the citations, and 50% of the articles published in the journal accounted for 90% of the citations. That means the rest of the 50% of articles could account for only 10% of the citations. If at all one of my paper is there amongst this percent, 10%, should it be given the same credit as this articles which were falling in this rest of the 50% which are accounting for 90% of the articles, citations? No. So impact factors does not permit quality assessment of an individual paper. Does impact factor permit assessment of a quality of an individual scientist? Let's see here. This is a graph of a work of a single author over a period of 17 years. On the x-axis, all those articles in which his work was published, that is the journal impact, were taken. For those articles which are in different journals, all those impact factors were taken. On the y-axis, the impact received for his articles, that is the citation counts, were taken. So on an average, his journal impact was 3.1, but his article impact was much more, which is 7. So this impact factor cannot be used for assessment of the quality of a work of an individual author. So the impact factors for the dentistry section can be taken from JCR every year in the year June, July, under the category dentistry, oral surgery and medicine. And you can see, depending upon your subjects, whether you're a periodontist or an endodontist or an orthodontist, and those journals belonging to your specialty which are having the impact factor and which are having higher impact factor. But if you are looking for those trendy journals, is that you look for an impact factor or something else? You should not look for an impact factor, but you should look for immediacy index. So what is this immediacy index and how is it calculated? Is the same way for the year IJMR, in the year 2012, the immediacy index was 0.328. That means the number of citations for the year 2012, for those which were published in the year 2012, so the number of citations received were 65, and the articles which were published in the year 2012 were 198. So the count is 0.328. So it measures and shows how fast articles are cited following their publications. So this immediacy index will tell us which are those journals which are publishing the emerging areas of research. So now during this pandemic, most of the articles which are published were on COVID. So you should look for the immediacy index of those journals which are publishing these emerging areas of research than going for an impact factor, because impact factor takes at least 2 years or a 5-year impact factor. But the disadvantage of this immediacy index is frequently issued journals may have an advantage, because few journals are published monthly, few are published twice in a year, few quarterly. So this discrepancy can be there, so adjustments need to be done for it. And articles which are published early in the year, maybe which are published in Jan, will have more citations than which was published in the year in the month of December. So this need to be used with care. There is something else which most of us would have heard about, is cited half-life. So what is this and how is it calculated? Is the same way, if I say calculate cited half-life for IJMR for the year 2012. So in the year 2012, I'm going back in time, and since the journal started publishing articles, so I'm going to write the cumulatively the number of citations for each year. And way back, again in time, I'm going back and seeing where that 50% split has occurred. So that split has occurred around 2006 and 7. That means 50% of articles were before 2006 and 7, and 50% of our articles published in the journal was after 2006 and 7. So that means the cited half-life is 6.5 years for this particular journal from 2012. Halfway for 50% means 6.5 years, which is 2006 and 7. So it's a measure of how long articles in a journal continue to be cited after publication. So you should look for those journals which are having cited half-life at least more than 10 years. That means even after 10 years, 50% of your articles are published in that particular journals are still being cited, illustrating the importance and longevity of the articles published in that particular journal. It is not those journals which are cutting edge type, but still even after a very long time, your articles will be still be cited, and those telling about the consistency of those journals, that is what cited half-life actually tells us. So what to calculate amongst these three? Then it should be a 2-year journal impact factor, excluding the self-citations. Still, impact factor is influenced by many social and statistical factors, as I said, like subject, the type of a journal, there's so many things you need to keep in mind. But still, Garfield said, this impact factor is like a nuclear energy, a mixed blessing. Best journals are still those which are the most difficult to get an article accepted, and these journals are having a high impact factor. These days, other than an impact factor, the librarians are looking for those matrices because it is so much expensive to get different journals in their library collection. So new metrics which has come is the engine factor and article influence score. The H of engine factor or the impact factor is, what does this engine factor tells us is, even a single citation from a high quality journal should be given more weightage than multiple citations from a peripheral publication. So it's a measure of importance. So how is it calculated is, think if I am a researcher, so I am looking for a topic on bite marks. So I go, and this is done online. So I go to a library online and search for a topic on bite marks. So I read maybe that particular article is published in our forensic dental sciences. So I read the article. From that reference list, I go to some other journal. From that journal, from that reference of an article, I go to another journal. So that amount of time as a researcher, I am spending with each journal. It's a mathematical algorithm. That is how it is calculated, the engine factor. This is calculated like how Google ranks the web pages using the hyperlinks. The same way, how much time a researcher is spending on each journal over a period of 5 years, that gives an engine factor. That means each researcher is spending on this particular journal and another journal, another journal. That means even the citations received for those articles should be from a high quality journal, and how that engine factor increases more. So keeping each article in mind, not the, just the whole cumulative journal, for each article in that particular journal should be given weightage. That is what article influence score is used for. If at all if the score comes more than one, it indicates that each article in that particular journal have been given a more weightage, more influential, using the engine factor score. This is calculated. But still, all these article influence score and engine factor high values are for those journals of Science, Cell and Nature, and no way we have our dental journals in this category. So what about those journals which are not indexed in Web of Science, which are indexed in Scopus? They do not have an impact factor. Then what do you look for? Look for site score, which is exactly nothing but the impact factor. But the only difference between site score and the impact factor is, impact factor is calculated. So the other metrics which are available in Scopus are SNIP, source normalized impact per paper. Source normalized impact per paper is having much more edge over journal impact factor, is because there are correction done for field differences. As I said, journal impact factor cannot be compared between two different fields. Just look at this particular example. There are two different journals, a mathematics journal and a molecular cell journal. The raw impact per paper actually is a journal impact factor, which is more for a molecular cell journal, is about 13, and it is 1.5 for mathematics journal. So that means this molecular cell journal is good. You just look at the citation potential. The citation potential also is more for molecular cell, which is about 3.2, which is very less in case of mathematics journal. So you should look for the citation potential too. So SNIP is RIP upon citation potential. So 1.5 upon 0.4 is 3.8, and 13 upon 3.2 is 4. More or less, these two got the same SNIP values because the correction were done for field differences. That means both these journals are more or less the same quality. Another important metrics which need to be looked for is SGR ranking, which is known as Science Imager Journal Ranking, as the same way it is calculated for an engine factor score, which I've just explained in Web of Science, telling that which are those journals which are more likely to have articles by cited by prestigious journals, not simply those journals which are cited the most. So under dental section for the year 2019, I was looking for those journals which are having the high SJR ranking. It was Journal of Dental Research, followed by Clinical Implant Dentistry and Related Research. Indian journals, the Journal of Indian Prosthodontal Society was on top, followed by Journal of Conservative Dentistry. So these are the journals having the high SJR ranking, saying that these are the journals which are cited by other good journals, not that just journals which are having more number of just citations. So this was little different from the year 2016, which was Conservative Dentistry, which was on top, which has come down. So what you need to keep in mind is every year these rankings keep changing. If at all these journals do not keep up to the quality of these citation databases, they do remove from them too. So when you look at a journal level metrics, when you're looking for a quality of a journal, look for impact factor or site score or SGR ranking, depending on which citation base you're looking for. Looking for the trendy journals, look for immediacy index, looking for those journals which are you want your articles to be cited for a very long time, and these journals are having those consistency, so you look for cited half-life. So sharing some national buzz. So during this pandemic, the husbands were having this problem at home, the domestic violence, and India was ranked third, Egypt on top, and UK being on the second number. So jokes apart, for the prize, the impact and relevance of the research is unquestionable. What about the rest of us? How does one quantify the cumulative impact and relevance of an individual scientific research output? That means as an individual researcher. So these are our speakers at the PG convention of stalwarts of oral pathology. So when I had a word with them and I asked them, when you're assessing an author, what should you look for, madam? Should it be the total number of papers of an author? So the answer which came from them was, though they measure the productivity, does they measure the importance or impact of their papers? That means if I'm having around 500 papers, just having citations around 50, that I have not made any impact. Then should it be the total number of citations? So the answer which came from them was, though it measures the impact, but what if he or she is a co-author in many of those papers, and undue weightage is given to review articles? If I am having so many review articles than original research, why should I be given so much of weightage? Then I said, should it be the cites per paper, that is total number of citations upon the total number of papers? Then they said, okay, this is having a superior indicator of other metrics, but it rewards the low productivity and penalizes the high productivity, because few articles will have zero citations or one or two, so it even rewards them, and few might have some 300-400 citation, it penalizes them, so that average is not very good. Then I said, should it be the number of significant papers, defined as the number of papers with Y citations? They said, okay, it might eliminate all that which you have asked, the criteria 1 and 2 and 3. But this Y is very arbitrary and it needs to be adjusted for different levels of seniority. How can you say that Y, anyone having with papers with 100 is good, with the 200 is good? Then I said, should it be the number of citations with each of the Q most cited papers? Then they said, still this Q is also very arbitrary, which will favor and disfavor individuals. So then I said, what should we look for? They said, you look for H index for an individual scientific research output to quantify him or her. A scientist has index H, means H is the largest number of his or her N papers receiving at least H citations each. And how is that calculated? Think if a researcher is having 5 publications A, B, C, D, E with 10, 8, 5, 4, and 3 citations, So H index is 4 because its first publication is having 4 citations. So to make it very easy to you, think I have some 25 publications and I have citations ranging from 13 to 312. So I just put them in a decreasing order, my citations from 312 to 13. And I'm looking for that position where my number of citations are equal to and or more than the ranking position. So if you see here, the ranking at ranking position 18, my number of citations are also 18. So it should be either more than or equal to, but not less than. So the next number is less. So my H index is 18. Which means that the scientist is rewarded for having a range of papers with good levels of citations rather than just one or two outliers with very high citations. So it's a combination of both quantity, that is the number of papers, and quality, that is the impact these papers have made. And this is very easy to calculate, just as I said, but the shortcomings of this H-index is a new person, a new researcher will not have an H-index, and you don't publish for a long time, your citations keep increasing, your H-index also keep improving. So that is some shortcoming which need to be corrected with some index variance. You should look for H-index with the author, with as a first author or a corresponding author with a fixed range of years, maybe the 10 years, 15 years or 20 years. You cannot compare two scientists with an experience of 10 years and other with the experience of 20 or 50 years. So all this need to be adjusted and then only H-index need to be used. I was boasting about my H-index to my better half, who's an orthodontist, but the answer what he gave me about when I said my H-index is bigger, but more people know who I am. It's actually, they are the people who are dealing with the patients and really give a smile to them. So obviously they are more and more famous than actually the researchers. To overcome this metric of H-index, where the more weightage was not given by highly cited articles, so one more index came, that is known as G-index. So the articles ranking from the decreasing order, that is a number, depending on the number of citations they have received, from the largest number it is arranged to the least number. So it is that largest number, the top G articles have received at least G square citations. So if any author is having G index 30, means his top 30 most cited articles, his or hers, combined have at least 900 citations. So then only you get this G index of 30. So it cannot be a bigger number than the articles published. So I10 is generally seen in Google Scholar just lying down next to H-index. It does not actually tell a compelling story. It only tells us how many of your articles have at least 10 citations. So there is this something called as research gate score also, which is based on all metrics score. You have to register yourself in the website which I mentioned here. This is a closed peer network system designed for researchers in science. And you have to upload all your articles in your research gate, and the metrics you get depending on the views, the bookmates amongst this particular network, it's the level of the influence a user has within the research gate. That is how this research gate score is also calculated. So when you talk about an individual research output of an author, then you'll go for H-index, but again specify the database, because in a Google Scholar it will be a different number, in Scopus it will be a different number. As I said, for seniority, you cannot compare two persons with different levels of seniority. Look for H-index as a first author only. Don't consider them as in co-authors also in different articles. So there's so many things which need to be looked in mind, and then only you have to use this metrics. So the take-home message is, always use both qualitative and quantitative inputs into your decision. Always use more than one research metric as the quantitative input. So hence, on the part of science, it is imperative to keep with the evolving science of metrics, understand the limitations and the uses of them, and use them to the best of your advantage. So metrics must be applied appropriately depending on the goal and subject of evaluation. So just can you identify these people? They are the producers of the movie Bahubali, which they made such a fantastic movie, but still they have done all the promotions so that many people come and see the movie. The same way you have published an excellent paper, but still it's still not receiving citations. ethically there are methods to increase the visibility of your paper. Make lay summaries of it, present at the conferences, mention about it on Twitter or Facebook, share links to your articles, share your databases, talk about it on your blogs. So you have to blow your own trumpet so that people recognize your work, read your work, and appreciate your work, and obviously you will get more citations. So I conclude by saying, research with the right intent that is useful for the society is the need of the hour. If you really want to take our research quality to new heights, let us shun the rat race and take the road less traveled in the future. Writing makes a record, a mark on the wall, no matter how small. Once written words becomes one's offspring, the stories and the messages will live on as an evidence, one's presence on the planet and engagement with life. So readers must hone their inquiry abilities and develop high degree of skepticism regarding the scrutiny of science. So in the spirit of science, let's keep learning and experiencing and keep practice and dissemination of science evolving for the times. So many people say that it's the intellect who makes a great scientist. It's not that, but it's a character. With this, I'd like to thank again the team IPL, Innovative Pedagogical Learning, Dr. Aman, Dr. Priyanka, Dr. Deepika, Dr. Pooja, for giving me this opportunity to present this webinar. I'd like to thank my guide, Dr. Sushmita Saxena, because of whom what I am today. I'd like to thank the management, Dr. Shalya Raj, who's the CEO of Swami Vivekananda Subharti University, the Vice Chancellor, Dr. N.K. Aujar, sir, Principal, Subharti Dental College, Dr. Nikhil Srivastav, sir, for always being in support, my family, and all those participants. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Thank you once again. This is my bit of effort. If anybody wants to add on something or any questions, most welcome. Thank you.
I request Dr. Vanna to please stop the sharing so that we can proceed with the question answer session.
Okay. Done?
Yeah. Guys, you have posted questions. Anybody who wants to post question can post more. Dr. Priyanka will be taking over the question answer session. Before we start with that, I would like to apologize. First, we could not log in the YouTube, and then we some other YouTube we tried to log in, and now we were live 45 minutes past 45 minutes. It's properly functioning on Facebook Live, and we are good to go for question answer session. Over to Dr. Kapoor for question answers.
Dr. Vanna, it was such a power-packed lecture. I think everybody is still zapped and they need some time to post their questions probably. And everybody is just complimenting you time and again. Awesome presentation. So you have amazing reviews. But I think they are taking time to, you know, gather their thoughts and post their questions. We have a few questions though. Dr. Pushpanjali has asked, how do we look for an impact factor before we send our article for publication? Where do we look for it actually?
Actually, as I mentioned, impact factors, or you need to get a subscription of Web of Science. In Web of Science, in the section dentistry, oral surgery, oral medicine, all the dental journals which are indexed in that, you get an idea. Sometimes it is available on Google too. Lately, I have just checked for whether it was available for 2019 and 18, but it was not seen. So that's why the old list I have provided in this presentation. But you need to have a subscription to look at those. But if you look at a particular journal, if at all it is indexed in Web of Science, the impact factor is mentioned on the website of the particular journal. But if you want a whole list of those articles, you need to have a subscription, and only those articles which are indexed in Web of Science under this section, as I said, dentistry, oral surgery, oral medicine, database of JCR. Every year, June, July, they do provide this impact factor. So you get the list of all those dental journals available.
So do we have to have an institutional subscription for it?
Yes, you need to have an institutional. It can't be a personal subscription. And if you are looking for Scopus Index journals, if impact factor is not there, to look for CiteScore and go for those journals which are having the CiteScore or the high SJR ranking on dental. This is freely available. Few Scopus tools are freely available, because even those Scopus also does require a subscription. SGR ranking and all are freely available online tools. So you can, under that section, dentistry, if you put Indian journal separately, there are two sections, all countries and India. If it is all countries, the whole dental journals available, you can get. If it is Indian journals, which are dental journals, are also available. SGR is a free, freely available tool. So it's also equally good. You can consider it as an impact factor. More than actually.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vanna. Dr. Aman has asked, how do we go for Scopus indexing? If we have a journal and we want to go for indexing, what is the way to go for a Scopus indexing?
The Scopus indexing, you need to go to their website and actually think for ask for all those rules and regulations of their criteria. There's a big list. Even I can't provide it right now. You have to consult, because I do have the number of the Scopus person, because they have come to a college many times due to NAC inspections. So they have provided a big list actually, so that these things should be there to actually index that in Scopus.
The reason why I asked was that, you know, this question is asked to me very often, but I'm not saying that I know the answer completely, but usually it exceeds the whole entire list of your previous publications which have happened. They try to gauge it on those basis. There is a list, as you are saying, of course, because there are people who have started their journal in every nook and corner. They should be aware that to increase the bar and standard, they have kept few parameters to really go about.
Yes. They have a lot of parameters, and it is not easy to get indexed. And if at all the journal is indexed too, if it doesn't follow their criteria, they can even remove it easily. There's so many journals which they are inactive journals in Scopus, which they call it as. So in journal, if you see in Scopus indexation, there are some active journals, there are some inactive journals. So inactive journals are those journals which were early indexed in Scopus, but because they were not following their criteria, they have removed it from them. So again, if they have to come back to that, they will have to again live to their level actually.
Dr. Vanna, impact factor seems to be the talk of the day. Okay. And people are still having those queries. So if we don't have an institutional subscription, and if the impact factor is not seen on the website also, can we also write to the journal authors and we can ask them? Is that the proper way?
Actually, most of the time in the website of the journals, it is mentioned. But few people, the editors, I must not tell this, they do say that it is having an impact factor, but frankly speaking, they do not.
No, they also confuse us with the RJ impact factor also.
Yes.
So they don't mention it is Thomas Reuter, it is Web of Science. Yes, they will not say that. They'll just say it's an impact factor. So that's confusing. I totally agree with you.
Yes. So again, as I say, our dental journals to have an impact factor are very less. And for us Indians to get those articles published in those highly impact factor journals, it's really next to impossible. I say it's not possible, but it's very, very hard. So
I would like to add here one more intelligent thing which has happened recently. I was searching for a PubMed index journal, and I realized that my student was saying that, you know, it is not getting published. Let's publish in this because it is PubMed index. Now, when I search in the PubMed list, the journal was not there, but on the website it was given. So they cleverly mentioned it is PubMed. The sign was there, and in bracket it was there mentioned. That means your citations have been mentioned in PubMed. That's the reason you are PubMed mentioned.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have to, you know, beware of all these tactics also. Dr. Pushpanjali is again posing a question: how to access scholarly articles which don't have open access to PDF format, since we need it for our references.
Mostly in the citation databases, as I mentioned, scholarly, there are different databases. So we should not get confused with them. The full articles databases are different. Bibliographic databases are different. Citation databases are different. So citations are databases or which they are getting citation, they're getting the metrics about all these articles. They need not actually have the full articles in them. But still, if you say these days, if you look at an article, you can see next to that the Allmetrics score also, the views, downloads, and all. If it's an immediate publication, you can even look at them. If you see, though it's in just an abstract, the citation analysis also is mentioned. Look at the citations. Those things are mentioned next to the article, though the full article is not there.
That brings us to a basic question. How do we choose PubMed indexed or open access? You know, when we go, when we send for publishing, because one is having more impact, and if we want more citations, we go for open. What is the basic
advice? No, the thing is, you have to go for an open access journal, but if the quality of the journal is not good, we should never go for it. Always, the quality of the journal comes on an upper hand. Then only it is an open or a closed access, that doesn't matter. As I said, if I am having an international publication, but I am not having so many citations as an Indian journal, so that means it doesn't mean that my international publication, which was just having 50 citations over my 300 or 400 citation to an Indian journal. So I cannot compare these two. So they're two different things. So go for a quality journal, though it is open or closed access. But with the time, what happens is the journals also, they do open. After certain time, they make it free. It's not that they keep it closed for a long time. So after certain time, they make it free and the article can be seen. So you should always go for the quality than saying that it's being
open. And can we also improve our visibility by adding preprints to our profile before it is published? Are you in favor of that?
Not the preprints. As I said, you can talk about it, make it a little summary type and talk about it with different communities. Like, the thing is, if somebody poses any questions or they have their any comments on it, you need to correct it and again only send back again your publication.
And since you talked about NAC, you know, our university has made it mandatory for all of us to have our Google Scholar profile public. But still we see that many of these citations which are there in our account, they are not added on their own. So is there any way to add the citations to the Google Scholar?
Yeah, you actually, what happens is, it's better to follow the or make an ORCID ID, Open Researcher ID.
Yeah, ORCID ID.
Once you make this ORCID ID, what happens is, it is unique for you. So yeah, maybe there might be so many Dr. Priyanka's, there may be so many Dr. Vandana's. So what happens is, if you don't have this ID, other people, so I might write in few articles as V Reddy, I write in few as Vandana. So all those V Reddy, maybe somebody, some other person also, maybe Vamsi Reddy, V Reddy. So those articles also can add to my Google Scholar. And some of my articles which were published in a little different name might not add to my Google Scholar account. So you need to delete. There are options for delete and adding options in the Google Scholar. So you need to delete those which are not actually yours, and you need to add those which are yours. There are options available.
So can we go back and add our ORCID ID also? Because since maybe some of the researchers may have made that ORCID ID later on, and they might have publications.
Once you add your ORCID ID,
it gets automatically
all those. Yeah.
Okay. So I think Dr. Sumit, your question is also answered, because he was also having this query that if we have different versions of the same author, ORCID ID will solve your query also.
Yes, if it is Web of Science, then you need to make a researcher ID for others.
On Publons, is that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And this is a very basic question by a first year postgraduate student. She is asking, what topic should we select to write a research paper? I think she means by the way of visibility only, if I'm not wrong. Dr. Arundhati Patil, she has asked this question.
What
topic should we select to write a research paper?
It depends on, I don't know which specialty she is.
She's from periodontology and implantology.
You should ask her guide, actually.
Frankly,
I think it's basically on the visibility, I think.
What topic we should think of is, she should read all those journals belong to her subject category and look for those topics which are actually trendy, which are going in their specialty. And once she reads them, in every discussion section, they have some limitations. So that gives a scope for a new research, actually speaking. A novel idea, whatever is giving. So then she can get from those, depending upon the metrics about for those articles too. But we cannot say what topic to search for research from our side. She should check in periodontics.
Yeah. So this is the last question. How do the different databases, they assign different categories? do the different citation databases have different journal categories? As you said that we should look for in our journal categories. So are the categories same in all the different citation databases or are they different?
Sorry, I didn't get this question. There are different journals and different databases index. That's what you mean, right?
Yeah, different categories you said, you know, that we have to look, if we have to compare two journals, then it has to be in the same journal category. So how is the journal category defined by the different citation databases?
What does that mean is I said the few metrics when I talked about citations, I think you're an orthodontist, I am an oral pathologist, you have an article with about 500 citations, I have an article with 100 citations. Maybe my citation potential in my field is less, maybe the citation potential is more in your field because you orthodontists have been working for so long, there's so many PGs, so many faculty coming every year. The potential will be more in your field. So you cannot compare between your field and my field. That's what. So when we talk about these subject categories or sub-subject categories, so you can compare SGR ranking because there were corrections done for the field differences. Because your subject, my subject, if I say, you can still say my journal is having an edge over your journal because that correction was done. But if you say that impact factor of my journal is more than yours, that you cannot compare between our two journals because the citation potential was more in your journal. So these things need to be kept in mind.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vandana. It was an amazing, amazing session and an amazing question answers. I think more questions will keep on coming in, but we have a shortage of time. So I think I'll hand over to Dr. Pooja for a formal vote of thanks. But it was lovely hearing you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Priyanka. Thank you again, all of you. Such a short notice, you could arrange all this. Thank you again.
Dr. Pooja is Dr. Pooja right now. But
I'm here, sir.
With a photo only, without a video. So I'll transfer it to her. Where is she now?
Should I begin, sir?
No, I need to pin you first. Where are you? Can't see you.
You can stand up, Pooja.
I can't see you actually.
Pooja, I think you need to talk a little. Automatically, you'll become visible.
Sure, ma'am.
That is not a problem. Pooja can talk any length.
Where is Pooja? Oh, God. Can't see. Yeah. There she is. Please go ahead.
I hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes, please go ahead.
Well,
yes.
All's well that ends well. With this, today we have commenced our 10th lecture in the row, and we are really thankful to you, Vandana ma'am, for accepting our invitation at such a short notice. And we are actually very thankful to you for being here. We are honored by your presence, ma'am. Thank you. On behalf of our team, IPIL, I would like to thank you for sparing your time and being with us. I thought the session was really fruitful for each one of us, ma'am. We conduct our lecture under the aegis of INPAFO and AFHOR, for which we are always indebted to Professor Dr. Rakesh Goria, sir, and Emilio Nozolis, sir. And for the support of IACFI, we are grateful to Neeraj Grover, sir, and Jasuja, sir. And last but not the least, we are thankful to our audiences who are there with us ever for their support, for their enthusiasm. We are really grateful to you, each one of you. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Stay safe. We'll log off. Thank you.
Bye-bye.